Mbak Vera, ini bisa lihat screen saya?
Ya, sudah bisa, Mister. Sudah terlihat jelas.
Okay, thank you.
Jom. Okay, good morning everyone. Thank you for joining with us. Now our special speaker has been present with us ya. Mr. Sohel Rana BSS, MSS, MPH, PGD.
Mr. Spera.
Ya.
Please wait for a while, okay?
Oke, mau ini dulu Bu, perkenalan dulu aja sambil menunggu peserta yang datang, belum dimulai.
Oke,
for our student, thank you for joining. And for your information, all participant, Mr. Sohel Rana come from Bangladesh, ya. Yeah? And how lucky we are can meet him at this special moment. Oke, maybe kita sambil menunggu peserta yang masih masuk, mungkin di sini saya akan mungkin memperkenalkan ya secara garis besar nih dari Mr. Sohel ini ya. Mr. Sohel Rana is a public health professional with over 6 years of experience specializing in the areas of project implementation, community outreach, sexual and reproductive health, health systems strengthening, primary health care, social behavior change communication or SBCC. And Mr. Sohel completed his bachelor and master in anthropology from Jahangir Nagar University. He completed master of public health from Universitas Gajah Mada, Yogyakarta, under scholarship by Indonesian government. And Mr. Sohel has wide experience in the field of public health. And currently, he's working for USAID's Advancing Universal Health Coverage, led by ThinkWell. And prior ThinkWell, he worked for the World Health Organization for emergency response for Rohingya refugees at Chowk's Bazar, Bangladesh. USAID's funded project implementation for ABT Associates and John Hopkins University for different community focus project implementation. And he has contributed to numerous publications on UHC, tobacco, and other areas of public health. So amazing, yeah, Mr. Sohel.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, before we will this event, attention please, the honorable speaker and all participants. Before that, I will announce the expert lectures code of conduct. Number one, all participants, please turn off the microphone so as not to interfere with the smooth running of the event. Number two, participants are not expected to spam in the chat field. Please use the chat field if there is something to be said or there is something unclear. Number three, all participants can fill in the list link present on the link and will also be shared by the committee in the chat field. Number four, there will be a question and answer session. Participants who want to ask questions can click the raise hand icon and the moderator will point to who is given the opportunity to ask. Once welcomed by the moderator, participants can ask directly. Number five, participants who get a certificate only meet the terms and conditions, fill in the registration link, attendance link, and evaluation link. So please follow from the beginning to the end of this expert lecture session. Oke, jadi para peserta dimohon untuk menonaktifkan speakernya selama acara berlangsung. Dan jika ada pertanyaan atau ada beberapa hal yang ingin didiskusikan, silakan untuk mengklik tombol raise hand-nya. Ya. Bisa difahami ya. Dan juga selama acara berlangsung ini peserta wajib nanti mengisi link absensi dan evaluasi yang nanti akan disediakan oleh panitia. Oke, harap diperhatikan ya. Oke, dan beberapa saat lagi kita akan memulai acara ini.
Assalamualaikum, Mr. Sohail.
Waalaikumsalam, Mas. Apa kabar?
Kabar baik, Alhamdulillah. Gimana, Mr. Soha? Kabarnya sehat?
Alhamdulillah sehat.
Gimana kabar keluarga? Sehat?
Alhamdulillah semua sehat.
Syukur Alhamdulillah. Maaf ya, terlambat ini baru nyampe kantor.
Gak apa-apa.
Oke, baik Pak Cecep, mungkin bisa kita mulai.
Oke, boleh, silakan Bu.
Oke, bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Before that, excuse me Mr. Sohel, we apologize in advance if my English isn't good enough. Is it permissible to use bilingual Indonesian and English? Oke, thank you so much. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Sampurasun. Best regards from me. Alhamdulillahirabbil alamin wassalatu wassalamu ala asrofil anbiya'i wal mursalin sayidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajmain. Robbi shohli sodri wa yassirli amri wahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahul qawli amma ba'du. The honorable board of supervisor, chairman, treasurer and secretary of Bakti Husada Educational Foundation Kuningan. The Honorable Chairman of Institute of Health Science Kuningan or STIKES Kuningan, Mr. Haji Abdul Rahim, SKPMH, and on this day represented by Mr. Cecep Heriana, SKMMPH, as a Vice Chairman and his ranks. And then the Honorable Head of Bachelor, Professional and Diploma Midwifery Program, Mrs. Ayi Nur Asiyah, SSTMKM. Mrs. Siti Nunung Nurjanah, SSTMKM, and Mrs. Mala Trimarliana, SSTMKES, and the ranks. The Honorable, our speaker of expert lecture today, Mr. Sohel Rana, BSS, MSS, MPH, PGD, as a program manager for the Thinkwell LLC, Health Field Coordinator, World Health Organization Emergency Response for Rohingya Refugees. Thank you for your presence. The honorable all guests and participants who cannot be mentioned one by one that I am proud of, thank you for the presence. For the first, let us pray and let us say thanksgiving to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala who has given an abundance of his grace so that we can attend the expert lecture activity with the theme is maternal and child health in emergency case from Rohingya refugees Bangladesh on Monday 7 June 20 and 21 virtually in healthy and happy condition. Don't forget to send salawat and greetings to our great prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam whom we hope for intercession in the hereafter. Amin ya rabbal alamin. Okay, excuse me, I'm Ferraris Wida Utami Herwandar as a Master of Ceremony or MC. Please allow me to read the schedule or agenda for today. One, opening speech. Number two, welcome speech. Number three, submission of material. Number four, question and answer discussion. Number five, certificate submission. Number six, shared photo session. And for the last closing pray. Okay, the honorable participants, moving on to the first event, the opening speech, let us open this event by reading basmalah together or according to each other's beliefs.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
Thank you. Next, let us watch the video of Asmaul Husna together. Okay, IT team, please helping us.
Astaghfirullah. 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 Ya Allah, ya Rahman,
Kudus ya salam ya mu'min ya muhaimin, ya aziz ya jabbar ya mutakabbir ya khaliq, ya bari' ya musawwir ya ghaffar ya qahhar, ya wahhab ya razzaq ya fattah ya alim ya qabir ya basit ya khafiq ya rafi' ya mu'iz ya mudhil ya sami' ya basir ya hakam ya adil ya latif ya khabir ya halim ya azim ya ghafur ya syakur ya alim ya kabir ya hafiz ya mukim ya hasib ya jalil ya karim ya شهيد يا حق يا وكيل يا قوي يا متين يا ولي يا حميد يا محصي يا مبدي يا معيد يا محيي يا مميت يا حي يا ميت يا وجيل يا يا قادر يا مقتدر يا مقدم يا مؤخر يا أول يا آخر يا ظهور يا باطن يا ولي يا متعالي يا بار يا تواب
يا منتقم يا عفو يا يا مالك الملك يا ذا الجلال والإكرام
يا مقسم يا جامع يا غني يا مؤمن يا مانع يا ضار يا نافع يا
Okay, thank you. May it be blessed for all of us. Amin, ya Rabbal Alamin. And then, singing the Indonesian national anthem, ladies and gentlemen, please put your right arm on your left chest. Thank you. Jadi, peserta dimohon untuk menyimpan lengannya di lengan kanan di sebelah dada kiri.
Indonesia.
Thank you. The honorable participants, the second agenda is welcome speech from Vice Chairman of Stikes Kuningan, Mr. Cecep Heriana, SKM, MPH. Time is yours.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Vera, ya, selaku MC. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Pertama-tama marilah kita panjatkan puji dan syukur kehadirat Allah Subhanahu wa taala. Yang alhamdulillah berkat rahmat-Nya kita semua bisa hari Senin ini mengikuti kegiatan webinar ya, kuliah pakar. Ya, yang hari ini kita mengundang Mr. Sohel, Sohelana. He is my friend. Thank you Mr. Sohel for your attention at your attendance ya. For your presence. Thank you. Salam besar salam semoga terlimpah curah kepada Nabi besar Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam kepada para keluarganya, para sahabatnya dan kita semua selaku umatnya. Amin ya rabbal alamin. Bapak Ibu hadirin semua, I speak in bahasa ya. Sekalian saya menjelaskan profil ya, profil Stikes Kuningan. Saya izin share screen. Mr. Sohel, kita sering berkomunikasi, namun kita mungkin kesempatan ini kita bisa menyampaikan langsung bagaimana profil Stikes Kuningan. Pemikiran kita perlu menyampaikan satu isu-isu global maupun regional ASEAN terkait dengan reproductive health, gitu ya, child health, maternal health, gitu ya. Nah, oleh karena itu saya senang sekali Mr. Sohel mau mengisi kesempatan ini, kuliah pakar ini. Yang pertama, kita memang berada di rural area. Kita berada di pedesaan. Kita ada di kampung, gitu ya, kalau bahasa Indonesianya. Tentu isu-isu yang kita hadapi adalah isu-isu yang sama mungkin seperti di Bangladesh atau mungkin sama dengan di negara-negara ASEAN yang lainnya. Nah, oleh karena itu, meskipun posisi kita ada di pedesaan, di rural, kita mencoba menjamin mutu pendidikan ini dengan sebaik mungkin. Kita berupaya optimal ya untuk menghasilkan satu lulusan yang kompetens. Tentu dalam hal ini adalah profesi bidan gitu, atau S1 kebidanan. Inilah kampus kami, Green Campus, ya Mr. Sohel. Mudah-mudahan satu waktu Mr. Sohel bisa ke Indonesia kalau memang sudah tidak pandemi lagi.
Betul? Ya, insya Allah.
Ya, kita pernah merencanakan di tahun 2019. Ya, cuman kita belum sempat ketemu lagi ya setelah kita studi bareng di UGM. Ini Mr. Sohel, kami berdiri sebenarnya sejak tahun 2006. Ya, saat itu local government, kalau di istilah mungkin sini pemerintah daerah, memberikan scholarship beasiswa for midwife itu ya, jadi for midwife, jadi untuk bidan, untuk sekolah bidan pada level diploma, diploma 3 kalau di sini selalu. Nah, saat itu ada 30 orang disekolahkan. Nah, inilah cikal bakal history of Stikes Kuningan. Jadi saat itu memberikan beasiswa kemudian disekolahkan dari SMA ya, dari sekolah menengah atas. Nah, kemudian dalam perjalanannya kita ada dua program studi D3 kebidanan dan S1 keperawatan nursing, Bachelor of Nursing gitu ya. Nah, kemudian kita berkembang tahun 2007-nya kita dapat program studi professional education-nya nurse, kalau di Indonesia tuh ada professional education-nya, dapat izin nurse-nya. Kemudian kita buka Bachelor of Public Health, ya apa SKM, Sarjana Kesehatan Masyarakat Indonesia. Nah, itu kita berjalan, kemudian National Accreditation kita tempuh. Kemudian tahun 2018 kita berkembang, karena di Indonesia itu ada regulasi untuk midwifery, untuk bidan ini harus bachelor, ya harus professional education. Makanya kita memberikan S1 kebidanan dan profesi bidan. Nah, kemudian kita mengembangkan juga program magister, ya, jadi Master of Public Health-nya. Nah, ini yang ingin saya ceritakan ke Mr. Sohel. Mudah-mudahan menjadi bahan kita untuk mendapatkan mahasiswa asing dari Bangladesh maupun dari negara-negara lain. Kemudian Saya langsung ke ini. Inilah semacam apa namanya long planning ya, jangka panjang perencanaan kita jangka panjang di Stikes Kuningan. Kita sudah menetapkan tahun 2010 sampai 2015 ini the best regional. Kemudian the best sub-regional ya, sub-regional area. Nah, kita tahun 2016 sampai 2020 kita menargetkan our goal itu adalah the first regional. Regional itu West Java Province and Banten. Nah, itu regional itu. Nah, kemudian kita mendapat peringkat secara nasional ya, nasional ranking gitu ya. Nasional ranking itu kita 203 dari 2000-an perguruan tinggi di Indonesia. Ya, alhamdulillah ini menjadi satu motivasi untuk terus memperbaiki diri, continuous quality improvement gitu ya, Mr. Soal. Dan mudah-mudahan di fase 2 kita 2021-2025 kita masuk pada 100 perguruan tinggi terbaik di Indonesia. Dan saya tentu akan terus bekerja sama dengan Mr. Soal untuk menyebarkan dari internasional. Nah, ini capaian kita. Jadi kita memang tahun 2020 adalah upaya maksimal kita. Tapi kita masuk lagi fase yang kedua tahun 2021. Mudah-mudahan kita makin naik rankingnya ya. Dan itu sebagai satu informasi yang perlu saya sampaikan. Kita memiliki program studi ada 7. Yang pertama yang tadi saya sampaikan mulai dari kita berdiri dari D3 bidan ya. D3 bidan, kemudian profesi satu keperawatan, profesi nurse, kemudian berkembang satu public health gitu ya. Kemudian berkembang lagi S1 kebidanan, profesi bidan, nah kemudian yang terakhir adalah master of public health. Ini memang kita sedang mengajukan national accreditation for LAMPTKES kalau di sini lembaga akreditasi khusus untuk kesehatan gitu ya. Nah itu kemudian kita mengelola sejak 2000. Kalau saya di pimpinan sejak 2010 ya. Nah ini tim kita periode 2016-2021 dan dilanjutkan tahun 2021-2025. Saya sendiri Pak Ketua ini mohon maaf Mr. Sohel sedang tidak enak badan atau sedang sakit. Kita doakan mudah-mudahan segera pulih kembali. Kemudian saya dibarengi dengan Pak Ebit, kemudian dan Pak Heri. Nah, ini adalah tim yang akan kita lakukan bersama-sama sekarang bekerja. Nah, ini student body ya, mahasiswa kita memang kita mengalami penurunan ya, decrease student in masa pandemi ya, COVID-19 pandemic ini gara-garanya ini. Jadi kita turun ya jumlahnya dan sekarang kita sedang mengalami satu challenge, tantangan juga jumlah mahasiswa kita belum memenuhi target. Inilah the real fact in private school ya. Jadi memang kalau di perguruan tinggi swasta ya beginilah resikonya begitu ya Mr. Soal. Nah kemudian terbanyak adalah mahasiswa perawat nursing favorit program ya ini di Kuningan di Indonesia gitu rata-rata. Perawat lebih banyak ya kita dosen masih banyak yang master kita sedang melanjutkan banyak mendorong untuk dokter gitu ya untuk S3 begitu nah kita sedang dorong itu kemudian dan sertifikasi sebagai dosen kalau di Indonesia itu ada istilah sertifikasi. Kemudian mendorong publikasi internasional biar cepat sertifikasinya biar jenjang akademiknya bisa intinya proses quality improvement. Kita juga mendapat satu award ya penghargaan bahwa kita yang taat yang patuh ya terhadap pelaksanaan dari sistem monitoring and evaluation. Nah, ini salah satu keunggulan kita di Stikes Kuningan. Ada beberapa hibah-hibah lain yang kita terima masuk dari hibah revolusi industri dari Kemenristekdikti dan sebagainya. Di Indonesia ini sedang ada program namanya Kampus Merdeka Merdeka Belajar. Ya, mudah-mudahan ini bercerita sedikit ya Mr. Sohel. Jadi ada satu kebebasan student ngambil apa mata kuliah lain di prodi lain atau apa namanya proyek kemanusiaan. Ya, kenapa ini saya ambil Mr. Sohel untuk cerita tentang proyek kemanusiaan? Karena Kampus Merdeka Merdeka Belajar itu salah satu apa namanya aktivitinya, aktivitasnya adalah proyek kemanusiaan. Nah, jadi ini yang ingin kita dorong, bahwa saya mendengar kemarin di berita misalnya di Aceh ya, ada juga pengungsi Rohingya. Nah, iya kan? Itu ya, Mr. Sohel nanti bisa bercerita. Jadi itu salah satu isu-isu yang ada, dan belum lagi persoalan disaster bencana di Indonesia kan sering, pengungsi-pengungsi juga banyak sekali. Nah, ini yang ingin saya ingin saya tekankan pada kuliah pakar ini. Mari kita belajar dari Mr. Sohel bagaimana sebagai leader atau apapun istilahnya di sana di Bangladesh. Kemudian kita bagaimana setting di Indonesia, nah itu mudah-mudahan menjadi inspirasi dan mahasiswa bisa terlibat. Tahun ini kita ada mahasiswa yang apa namanya relawan ya kalau bisa disebutnya contact tracer for COVID-19, for COVID-19. Jadi ada 4 orang mahasiswa itu ditempatkan di puskesmas ya, public health center, jadi dia sebagai petugas contact tracer. Nah itu sebagai relawan. Kemudian nanti akan diekuivalen, dikonversi ke SKS, ke studinya gitu ya. Kemudian dia nanti akan dapat pengakuan gitu ya. Itulah cara Kementerian Pendidikan di Indonesia untuk mengakomodir berbagai pengalaman belajar ya. Student experience-nya itu dia akan dapat ya. Learning experience-nya dia akan dapat begitu ya. Itu saya kira sebagai informasi yang lain ya tentang. Dan beberapa yang udah kita lakukan, ada istilahnya kita ada apa namanya community empowerment melalui KKN ya, kalau di Indonesia itu KKN ya, tematik khusus mengenai COVID-19. Kita mereka udah pada bikin produk apa namanya herbal dan lain sebagainya begitu ya. Nah, kita juga mengembangkan sistem learning management system untuk apa namanya pembelajaran daring ya. Nah, mulai dari e-learning, kemudian learning resource and innovation gitu ya. Jadi kita mencoba menggunakan platform daring ya. Nah, ini mudah-mudahan ke depan Mr. Sohel juga berkenan menjadi salah satu lecturer di kami, kemudian bisa terlibat sebagai dosen, mengajar dan lain sebagainya. Ini salah satu cara kita membangun hubungan baik dengan Mr. Sohel dan tim di Bangladesh gitu ya. Ya, kita menempatkan sebagai innovative campus. Ya, kita mendapatkan dari Gubernur of West Java, Mr. Ridwan Kamil, sebagai kampus literasi kalau di sini sebutnya literacy campus, kemudian kampus siaga kependudukan, kemudian kampus standar proteksi kebakaran dan lain sebagainya. Dan kita sedang memimpikan kita mendapat satu pengakuan dari AUN QA ya, sebagai health promoting campus atau health promoting university seperti UGM begitu ya, yang dipelopori Prof. Yayi itu ya. Nah, itu salah satu apa namanya motivasi kita supaya memang betul-betul kampus ini sebagai tempat belajar bagaimana mempromosikan gaya hidup sehat gitu ya. Oke, kemudian ya, kami juga memiliki perpustakaan national accreditation for national library gitu ya. Kemudian akreditasi jurnal, ada Health Science Journal, Journal Public Health Innovation, Journal of Nursing and Practic Education, Journal of Midwifery Care. Nah, itu semua kita siapkan ya, untuk publish. Memang masih indexing Google Scholar ya, tapi kita by step gitu ya, bertahap lah begitu ya, nanti ada tahapan kita terindex Google, kemudian nanti naik kita terindex Copernicus, DOAS dan lain sebagainya. Oke, kemudian ya kita juga mendorong fokus on research. Ada funding beberapa sumber dana dari Global Fund melalui Kementerian Kesehatan ya. Kita bisa mendapatkan hibah untuk tuberkulosis, penelitian riset tentang TBC. dan kita juga sedang berkolaborasi untuk research venue dengan Badan Litbang kalau di sini Kemenkes ya, National Research Board from Kemenkes atau Kementerian Kesehatan. Oke, kemudian ya kita juga mendorong produk ilmiah atau hak kekayaan intelektual di sini ada buku ya, ada jurnal, ada proceeding dan lain sebagainya. Ini upaya kita menyebarluaskan, kita mengikat pengetahuan dengan buku, kita mengikat pengetahuan dengan publishing journal. Nah ini cara-cara kita ya, dan mudah-mudahan ini menjadi motivasi bagi para mahasiswa juga. Nah, kemudian ini ada beberapa sosial media Mr. Sohel atau teman-teman semua para peserta webinar bisa mengikuti sosial media kita, ada website, ada Facebook, ada YouTube begitu ya. Nah, kita juga mendorong web ranking, memang kita masih rendah ya, tapi kita web ranking kita coba angkat dengan isu-isu yang kita memang bermanfaat buat masyarakat. Nah, kita sedang mengembangkan ini Mr. Sohel, Integrated Field Laboratory for Academic System and Health. Nah, ini kita berharap semua tempat praktek ya, wahana praktek kalau di sini praktik area gitu ya, untuk learning, untuk akademik, untuk research, untuk community empowerment misalnya, itu terintegrasi kemudian menjadi satu basis data, big data. Nah, big data ini menjadi satu need, kebutuhan saat ini ya, sehingga itu dijadikan dasar untuk research ya. Nah, itu dengan hasil research kita kembalikan masuk ke dalam satu pembelajaran, learning gitu ya. Jadi integrated ya, jadi antara research, learning, kemudian community empowerment gitu ya. Nah, itu menjadi satu kesatuan. Nah, kita sedang mengembangkan itu memang tuntutan juga di national akreditasi standar gitu ya, sebagai standar ya. Oke. Ya, kita juga terlibat di Satgas kalau Indonesia ya. Memang Rennes apa namanya nih? Kalau Indonesia Satgas Covid atau Satuan Tugas Task Force ya.
Task Force ya.
Jumlahnya dua ya.
Ya itu. Ya, kita di local government ya, saya sendiri menjadi timnya, kemudian di data manajernya, kemudian ada beberapa teman-teman juga di trauma center, kemudian pemulihan ekonomi gitu ya. Nah, inilah peran-peran kita dalam penanggulangan COVID-19. Oke, inilah beberapa di antara prestasi ya, penghargaan yang diterima oleh para mahasiswa. Ada yang national scope, ada regional scope, ada local scope, ada kan international scope. Nah, ini prestasi itu. Yang diukur di akreditasi di antaranya adalah LIMS, kesesuaian antara bidang dengan bidang kerjanya. Jadi kalau nursing bekerja sebagai nursing gitu ya. Public health ya, banyak lah ya, sebagai field coordinator, kemudian epidemiolog, surveillance, health promoter dan lain sebagainya, itu banyak sekali. Nah, bidan juga sama, medical practice gitu ya, dia sebagai bidan. Nah, ini kita ukur di dalam akreditasi, oleh karena itu link and match ini menjadi penting di dalam satu penilaian penjaminan mutu atau kita kenal dengan quality assurance ya. Nah, inilah Mr. Sohel, mudah-mudahan kamu bisa melihat bagaimana gambaran ya, kampus kita yang kita sebut dengan Green Campus ini. Mulai ini kita ada lapangan olahraga gitu ya, kemudian ada perpustakaan, library, kemudian ada laboratori untuk midwifery gitu ya, untuk public health, untuk nursing, ruangan kuliah begitu ya, kemudian public space area gitu ya, ini depan kampus, ada juga musola atau masjid gitu ya, mosque. Kemudian kita memiliki computer based test ya, center computer based test, karena di Indonesia itu ada semacam exit exam itu ujian kompetensi nasional gitu ya. Jadi memang ada satu parameter yang diukur secara nasional untuk namanya uji kompetensi. Dan kalau tidak lulus uji kompetensi, maka ijazah tidak dikeluarkan. Jadi penjaminan itulah Mr. Sohel di antara gambaran kami. Nah, kita sorry, saya ada yang lepas satu. kerjasama ya. Kita ingin sekali kerjasama dengan Bangladesh. Kemudian kita bisa ada realisasi segera karena memang kita membutuhkan mahasiswa internasional, kita membutuhkan jejaring internasional untuk kita sama-sama penelitian. Sebagaimana kita ketahui bersama, saya dan Mr. Sohail sudah melakukan publish untuk
orang kan biasanya di
untuk proceeding tentang reproductive health ya, community clinic saat itu, dan mudah-mudahan ini menjadi satu informasi penting. Jadi saya stop share dulu. Jadi Mr. Sohail, I hope you can get experience, yeah, explain the your experience, your activity in refuge Rohingya, atau mungkin pengalaman lain terkait dengan reproductive health gitu ya. Nah ini harapan kita semua sehingga teman-teman bisa belajar dari sana bagaimana negara tetangga kita Bangladesh mendapatkan satu challenge ya, tantangan memiliki pengungsi Rohingya. Nah itu mungkin sebagai satu closing statement saya, dan selamat mengikuti kegiatan kuliah pakar pada pagi hari ini, dan hari Senin adalah hari kita memulai bekerja, dan semangat ya. Ini mahasiswa kita yang terlibat juga para praktisi ya, praktik bidan di puskesmas Mr. Sohail, di rumah sakit atau di dinas kesehatan begitu ya. Jadi mungkin ada yang sambil bekerja begitu ya, sambil melakukan aktiviti gitu ya, aktivitasnya. Oke, saya kira itu, mohon maaf kalau terlalu lama, dan memang yang penting sekali menurut saya untuk bisa menyampaikan ini ke Mr. Sohail ya, dan teman-teman Bapak Ibu semua yang ikut pada webinar pagi hari ini. Dengan mengucapkan basmalah, mari kita buka bersama-sama bismillahirrahmanirrahim acara kuliah pakar hari ini. Kita mulai. Selamat untuk prodi profesi bidan, satu bidan dan tiga bidan yang hari ini berhasil ya mengundang Mr. Sohail, orang yang luar biasa bekerja di lapangan. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you Mr. Cecep for the welcome speech. Okay, the honorable participants, the third agenda is submission of material from Mr. Sohail Rana, and for this session will be guided by moderator Mrs. Dera Sukmanawati, STRKEB, MKEB, MCE. Time is yours, Mr. Dera. Mrs. Dera, sorry.
Okay, thank you to the MC, Mrs. Dera. Ladies and gentlemen, and all the participants of this expert lecture, thank you for being here all today. May I have your attention? The expert lecture is about to begin. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, and good morning, everyone. First of all, I would like to say welcome you all to this expert lecture. On this occasion, we are going to have an opportunity to share ideas and listening to presentation from our prominent speaker, whom we believe will enrich our insight and knowledge regarding the theme of our expert lecture today. Well, before we begin the presentation today, I would like to remind all of the participants to turn on the camera and mute the microphone during the presentation. You can also join us by raising questions, and probably if you have questions, you can type them into our chat room. I will compile it and help you mention it later on the Q&A session. Before the presentation begins, allow me to introduce the speaker. This is Mr. Sohail Rana, BSS, MSS, MPH, PGD. Career summary is Mr. Sohail Rana is a public health development professional with over 6 years of experience. Okay. Specializing in the areas of project implementation, liaison, coordination, and communication, community outreach and trust building, sectoral approach for emergency response, sensitization on ground realities for Rohingya refugees, and government counterpart, establish the medical effort for the Rohingya refugees, uptake of essential service package, health system strengthening, primary healthcare and service delivery, refugee and emergency health, sexual and reproductive health, health coordination, monitoring, evaluation, community outreach, social behavior, change communication or SBCC, public health research, and healthcare financing. He has extensive experience to coordinate health sector's activities at World Largest Refugee Camp in Cox Bazar, Bangladesh. Mr. Sohel worked for the World Health Organization. Okay, please, I tip mohon untuk ke bawah sedikit untuk CV-nya. Ya, baik, Mr. Sohel worked for the World Health Organization for Emergency Response for Rohingya Refugee, USAID Fund Project Implementation, and Johns Hopkins University for different community-focused project implementation. Mr. Rana has experience working with Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Refugee Repatriation and Relief Center of the Ministry of Disaster Management and other directorates. He has contributed to numerous publications on UHC about tobacco and other areas of public health. Competency is project management, coordination, communication, and outreach, liaison and advocacy, donor relation, monitoring, evaluation, and learning, technical deliverable, social behavior, change communication, research knowledge, refuge health, and then for education is at 2019 postgraduate diploma in project management professional, complete postgraduate diploma in project management professional from Bangladesh Institute of Management Studies under Qualify UK, and then 2012 till 2014, Master of Public Health, graduate from School of Public Health, Faculty of Medicine, Gajah Mada University, Yogyakarta, Indonesia, under Indonesian Government Scholarship Program. And then at 2010 till 2011, Master of Anthropology, Faculty of Social Science, Jahangir Namar University, Bangladesh, and at 2006 till 2010, Bachelor of Anthropology, Faculty of Social Science, Jahangir Namar University, Bangladesh. And then, Mr. Sohel Rana can speak in Bangla for native speaker. English, very good comment in speaking and writing with IELTS score 6 overall. And Bahasa Indonesia, very good comment in Indonesian language, advanced level complete 1 year duration course from Faculty of Cultural Science, Gajah Mada University, Indonesia, and obtain 80% of marks. Wow, luar biasa sekali, Mr. Sohel Rana. Baik, without further ado, I would like to invite the speaker to deliver the presentation. Mr. Sohel Rana, time is yours.
Thank you, and is the huge introduction. Yeah, I didn't expect this introduction. Thank you, Patera, for the introduction. And thank you, Machete, for the opening remarks. Before going to the lecture, maybe I just put two issues. Jadi, bisa kerja sama. Karena itu, the background, for the background side, the platform for development practitioners. Ini jadi salah satu inisiatif dari teman saya, teman kami actually. Jadi bisa kerja sama di istiqah sama organisasi saya atau karena ada profesi atau student exchange, maybe we can work together and also some publications we already worked before, so we can continue it. Okay, so maybe let me share my screen. Oh, is my screen showing, Bafera?
Yes, we can see the
okay
PowerPoint, so, Mr. Sohel Rana.
Okay, thank you and welcome to the lecture. And I'm Bangladeshi and I can speak Bahasa Indonesia, but ini bahasa sehari-hari ya. Jadi kalau bahasa akademik mungkin saya tidak bagus, tapi saya lecture-nya tadi campur ya. Jadi ada English, ada bahasa Indonesia. Jadi kalau ada if you have any problem in understanding, please let me know or stop me anytime, or you can chat in the chat box. So I will explain again. Yeah. So don't feel hesitation. Yeah. So this is very informal lecture, and I am not the professional. I'm the professional development people, but not the academician. So please stop me anytime and we will discuss it. Yeah. So, okay. Thank you. And thank you for the patience and the assisting me. So, okay. So today we will discuss about the more on the maternal reproductive and child health in the emergency situation. So emergency more on is the just kondisi darurat. Emergency is the kondisi darurat. Jadi bagaimana ya kesehatan ibu dan anak during the kondisi darurat. Then we have the case from the Rohingya refugee. Is one more than 1 million refugee is in Bangladesh. So we will take case from them actually. So this is basically. So this is the arrival of the Rohingya people. So waktu datang di Bangladesh biasa karena Myanmar and Bangladesh ada laut. Jadi they came from the river. They crossed the river and came to Bangladesh. So this is actually the one of the arrival scenario for the Rohingya refugees here. And this is the residence of the Rohingya actually. So mostly now all of the houses are the tarpaulin and the bamboo made tents actually. This is very, very temporary, very, very temporary. And there is many risks. You can see the gunungan ya. Jadi kalau waktu hujan, musim hujan ada landslide. Jadi ada risk. Jadi very, very temporary situation actually. So this is the background. And before 2017, we have already some Rohingya people. It's about the 100 or 150,000 population Rohingya already come. After independence or before independence of Bangladesh, they already came actually. But in August 25, 2017, the bulk amount of Rohingya people used to come Bangladesh. So the influx, we call the influx, and it's about the 700,000 new Rohingya actually come to Bangladesh on 2017. And this is the one of the largest and fastest movement of the people in recent history. All over the world, this is the largest and the fastest movement. And not a single case you will find in the same time the 700,000 population come to from one displaced from one place to another place at a time. This is, there is no example actually. And the Rohingya people are mostly the Muslim minority, mostly Muslim, and they are the victim by the Buddhist Myanmar and the army of the Myanmar peoples. And the United Nations calls it the genocidal violence actually. So it's the ethnic cleansing. So ethnic cleansings follow the decades persecution and the human rights abuse. And now about the 88, almost 900,000 stated Rohingya refugees lives in the world's largest densely populated refugee camp in Kolkata. So it's about, we have the district and the sub-district. They are living in the two sub-districts, Teknaf and Ukhiya. And it's more than, this is the total number, but unofficially this number is more than 1 million. Unofficially number is more than 1 million actually. And this is the very densely household. See, this is very densely, yeah? And they have to share the bathroom. They have actually one room, more than 7 or 8 people used to live. So this is very densely and not the hygienic space for living actually. And out of this, the total refugees, half of the refugees are the children. And except that, there is the host community. Host community, that means the Bangladeshi peoples. In these two sub-districts, we have around the 405,000 host community population over there. And this is the some demographic profile. So you can easily see, lihat seperti, jadi kalau female and male, so jadi ada banyak, kebanyakannya itu ada perempuan. Jadi 52% is perempuan and 48% is the male actually. Jadi kalau umurnya kurang 1 tahun, 1% sama. Mostly some same, 1 to 4 years, 6%, 6%. 5 to 11 years, 11%, 12%. Then 12 to 17 years, 7%, 8%. But 18 to 59 years, 25%, 19%. So mostly the women in reproductive age, which is more relevant today's lecture, women in reproductive health live belongs in the 18 to 59 years this range actually, and this is the mostly complex situation, and the services are not available there, so they are facing the many challenges, and also the aging people more than 60 plus years, 2%, and you can see the 52% are the children. 52% are the children, 44% are the adults. And the 4% are the older people, and the 1% are the person with disability. So at least 1% of the total population, they have some types of disabilities. So, and this is the specific needs. So what was the specific needs for them actually? So first of them, you can see, there is during this problem or the influx, many children or many people lost their family members actually. The members yang keluarga adi hilang jadi yang jalan dari Myanmar ke Bangladesh, member yang the keluarga hilang jadi single parents. So ada caregiver 1.62% single caregiver. They need the caregiving facilities. Person with disabilities, they need this support. Serious medical conditions, see, so at least 26% female need the medical support, and this is the psychological support, and the separated children, older person at risk, children at risk. So this is the at least ultimate specific needs they require actually. And this is the okay. So now this is the more on the background of the Rohingya refugees in Bangladesh. Now we'll kita langsung masuk di kuliah hari ini. Jadi maternal and child health. So maternal and reproductive health, and we will discuss about the child health as well. So maternal reproductive health. So among the total population, about the 1 million refugees. Jadi dari 1 juta refugees, sekitar 324,000 Rohingya refugees, or the total population are in the women in reproductive age. So they are in, sometimes they are the in reproductive age actually. So in any time they can conceive or they need the care actually. And they need the special care on the SRIs, the sexual and reproductive health rights. And besides the 2.4% of the total population at any rate, at the pregnant woman. So out of the total population, about the 2.4% are the pregnant women. So that means if it is the 1 million total, so is about the 200,000 population are mostly or is the pregnant at any time actually. So this is the one of the health concern for the service provider or any people actually, to ensure the good service for the women during the pregnancy, after pregnancy, during delivery, in any times. So family planning, MR, menstruation regulation, and the post-abortion care. So we will discuss three things at a time. So family planning, menstruation regulation, and the post-abortion care. So mostly today I will discuss with the data from the 2022, because I have the data in the 2022, and the, from the this 2021 data is not yet revised actually. So we will mostly share on the data based on the 2020. So about the more than 3,000 family planning visit were recorded. This is family planning visit in the facility and also the community. Karena ada orang datang di rumah sakit atau di facility, health facility, ada CSW, community health worker, ada kunjungan di community as well. Jadi more than 300,000 family planning visit were recorded in 2020. And the, among them, they have the preference of the oral contraceptive pill. So most of the Rohingya mothers or the women, they prefer the pill actually, and the and the injectable contraceptives rather than the other method actually. So oral pill, because this is the one of the reason is the male people, they didn't like the family planning. Jadi perempuan harus ikut di family planning. Jadi suami mereka dia tidak ikut the family planning. Jadi untuk ini oral contraceptive and the injectable contraceptive are the most of the family planning method here. So 57% oral contraceptive pill and the 29 almost 30% the injectable contraceptive. Only 11% is the using the condom rate. So male partner really don't agree on the family planning. So for that reason, this is the scenario. And the acceptance of the long-acting reversible contraceptive LARC method recorded only the 4% among the first-time visitors, because this is mostly facility-based. Jadi, this is very low actually. And the ensuring the all family planning for all. So in 2020, this is the distribution rate actually. So this is this number of condoms and the oral pills and the contraceptives were actually distributed among the people. And the MR increased among the refugees. Menstruation regulation really increased because the mostly pregnancy are not planned pregnancy. So people used to who have the education or the who are more aware about the reproductive health care, they used to make it the planned pregnancy. But among the Rohingya, they don't have the planned pregnancy. For that reason, when they find out the woman is pregnant, the mother is pregnant, then they came to facility for the AMR actually. So for that reason, day by day, AMR is increasing. Then post-abortion care also increasing, because AMR is increasing and also the post-abortion care also increasing. And the overall, the almost 10,000 and the AMR and the 3,500 post-abortion care visited were done in 2020 actually. And mostly this is the recorded data, but before except that there is a many unrecorded data, because we don't know the abortion at the facility level, at the household level. So that the data is not here actually. And this is the family planning AMR, this is the family planning visit by month, because in 2020 in the April, May, June, so they have the COVID impact actually. So for that reason, there is a low visit, low performance, but in the July is increasing trend actually. So this is the mostly the family planning visit record by month. And the family planning visit by method. Jadi ini family planning KB ya, KB ya. Family planning itu KB ya. Jadi the family planning visit by method. So condom is only 0.7%, and implant is 1%. See, very low. And because this is more on the by the male partner, and sorry, IUD is 0.7% IUD, and the condom is 11%, injectable is the 29%, and the rest of the 57 largest amount by the pill, because women are more aware about the family planning. And this is the MR and the post abortion care by month actually. See, the MR is good in January, February, but is decreasing due to COVID. Due to COVID is decreased, and then it's increasing again. And so this is the things. And the post abortion care mostly same, but also decreased in the during the COVID cessation. COVID-19, and the trend mostly same, but in the end of the day is the increasing actually. ANC and PNC services. So let's see. Maybe sampai sekarang ada pertanyaan. Maybe we can answer question if you have any questions, so we can ask.
Belum.
But Vera, if there is any question, maybe we can take question up to sampai sekarang. Kalau ada pertanyaan, maybe kita bisa discuss.
Belum ada.
Okay. Then continue. Jadi ANC and PNC services among the refugees. So ANC and PNC visit at the healthcare facility level is very low actually. So people's atau ibu-ibu atau yang women in the reproductive age, mereka biasa tidak datang di facility atau rumah sakit untuk ANC or PNC visit actually. So because they are not aware about their health actually, or they didn't know they have to visit facility for the ANC when they will get pregnant, they have to visit. They don't know actually. And there are also some religious taboo, religious beliefs. They mereka tidak datang di facility untuk ANC PNC service. And some religious taboo provoke them not to go facility for the maternal reproductive health care seeking. And the SRA is working group, the sexual and reproductive health working group used to work for the increasing the sexual and reproductive health rights among the people, among the inhabitants or refugees, and they are trying to ensure the minimum eight ANC contacts with the pregnant mothers, and which will enable to reduce the prenatal mortality and improve the women's experience of the care. And this aid visit by the community health worker to the community, not in the facility. Facility is not possible. The aid for visit also not possible. And this aid visit is planned for by the CSW to the community. And postnatal care visit also been steadily increasing. And the day by day, the post-abortion care PNC also postnatal care also increasing, because people are more aware now, and we have now the wide range of the CSW catchment area. So for that reason, the CSW can easily go to the family and they can take care of the mother on the postnatal care. And this is C, the ANC first visit and the ANC service. So frequency of the ANC visit. So in January, see, so total visit also decreased in the during the COVID. Basically, all of the services are hampered by the COVID-19, COVID surveillance blast, and the impact COVID surveillance blast onto ANC and the semua health services. Jadi kalau ya di April, Mei, Jun, jadi itu tiga bulan jadi impact dari COVID-19. So this is the trend actually with the numbers. So this is the postnatal care. Postnatal care also impacted by the COVID semblance blast. And see postnatal in the end of the year, in the September, October, November, December, it was increased rapidly actually. Yeah? So it's back to the natural trend. So facility-based delivery and the birth. Yeah, facility-based delivery. So this is the one picture. This is the very fascinating. Gambar ini sangat menarik karena itu satu ibu kelahiran tiga anak at a time. Jadi ya three babies at a time delivered by same mother. So and the and it is one of the success story for the health facilities by the Turkish field hospital, from the Turkish government. They established the one field hospital and the delivery was occurred there actually. So this is the one good services actually. The facility based delivery and the birth. Yeah, compared with the 2017 or 2018, the facility-based delivery is increasing because when Rohingya lived in the Myanmar, they didn't get any health facilities and didn't know their rights or how the health facilities work actually. But when they came to this Bangladesh, the Cox's Bazar in Bangladesh, and there is many health facilities or agencies, Adabaniya organization, LSM, LSM local, LSM international, kerja di refugee camp. Jadi they are awarding the people. They are awarding the people about the facilities or the care about the PNC, ANC, and the with the examples. Jadi untuk facility based deliveries sekarang naik. Jadi total 17,000, more than 17,000 facility-based deliveries were recorded during 2020. So this is only the facility-based recording. Maybe someone raised hand. Yeah? Anyone? Any question? Because I saw someone have hand raising.
Okay, any question?
Yes.
You can raise your hand maybe. And okay, any question? Okay, alright, Mister, mungkin kita lanjut dulu untuk okay. Materinya.
Okay, yeah. Kita lanjut. Jadi ya, kalau tahun 2020, jadi ya lebih 17,000 facility-based delivery was occurred, and except that the home-based delivery, the community delivery is still going on. And see, the 6% of the total deliveries were reported from the girls under 18 years old. This is the very alarming, because by the procedure of the kesehatan ibu dan anak, jadi itu ada risk kalau Kalau ada orang kelahiran kurang dari 18 tahun, jadi ada risk ya. Jadi we found about 6% of the total birth was done by the girls and age under 18 years. So this is the for the midwives. Here is the we have space to work actually. And 5.1% of the facility-based deliveries were through a cesarean section. So out of this 17,000 facility-based delivery, 5% of the deliveries in the C-section actually. And the live birth with the low birth weight recorded is also contributed a very good number, but due to counseling and other things, it is the decline from, it was the 16 points in the first half of the 2020, it was a 16%, and the end of the December, it was only 7.3%. And the promotion of the, and this is decreased because of promotion of the evidence-based midwifery lead care practice. So here you midwives or midwives like you contributed a lot actually. So for promotion of the evidence-based midwifery cases. So the strengthening the newborn stabilization units, NSU, and the special care newborn units. So also from the donor part or the other UN agencies, they also strengthening the NSU and the SCNU, the special care newborn units actually. They establish the care in the camps as well as the district level hospitals. So for that reason, so they the newborns getting the more comprehensive services. For that reason, they are the death or is decreasing actually. And also the nutritional, and also the because of the nutritional support, the low births of the children is also decreasing. So this is the facility-based delivery and the live births record. See, the green one, the green one is the live birth and the yellow one is the facility-based delivery. See, in the December is the highest number deliveries done, but in the June, April, May, June is the lowest one, and it's all about due to the COVID situation actually. And this is the facility-based deliveries and birth. So facility-based deliveries, see, so about 10% live birth have the less than 2,500 grams actually. So 2.5 kilo, baby weight less than 2.5 kilo is the 10%, and the 90% have the standard baby weight during birth actually. And the percentage of the weight below, see, in the by month when it is more than less than 2.5 kilo. And in February and the June contributed more actually. And the facility-based deliveries and this is, so this is the facility-based deliveries is by mother. So see, already discussed 6.6% of the mothers who gave birth, their age is less than 18 years. So we call the not the women, we call the girls actually. Girls who have the age less than 18 contributed to 6% of the total delivery. And the women age more than 18% contributed 94% of the delivery. and see out of the total deliveries, the facility delivery actually, not the total delivery, only delivery in the facility contributed 5% in the C section and the 95% by the NVD, normal vaginal delivery. So obstetric complications. So maybe sampai sekarang ada pertanyaan?
Belum, Miss.
Okay, belum.
Ya, so, belum ada pertanyaan.
No, because my slide is finishing actually. So we have to. I'm not sure if you have any question, then we can ask. So okay, no problem. So we can finish, then we can ask. So obstetric complications. So see, the number of the reported obstetric complication has been raising from 4,488 complication was recorded in the 2020. So this is not the few numbers. Eh? So 4,488 obstetric complications were recorded actually. So this number of cases was found the complication during the pregnancy, during the delivery. And in 2020, majority of the reported obstetric complication were, and out of these cases, the mostly are the postpartum hemorrhage, 10%, and the severe preeclampsia or eclampsia is the 7%, and other contributed 83% annually. So we found many cases, the postpartum hemorrhage for these obstetric complications, most of the postpartum hemorrhage and the severe preeclampsia or the eclampsia. So this is the by month, the obstetric complication by month. So see, the mostly in August, we found the mostly complication, the majority complications. And the May, due to the COVID, May, June, this is the somehow the impact of the COVID actually, because people are afraid to come to the facility. See here, in November or December, 88 postpartum hemorrhagic was found. So this is not, and also the severe eclampsia, preeclampsia 64, and this is increasing, really increasing, and we have to work on it very, very carefully. And see by the two quarters, the January to June and the July to or December actually, the cases actually here. Obstetric completion by type. So see the postpartum hemorrhage. And the others completion 86%, postpartum hemorrhage in July 8%. And from January to June, postpartum hemorrhage is increasing in the July to December. July to December is 11%. So this is the alarming, and the midwives and the other health professionals will take care of it actually. Mortality and the stillbirth. Mortality and the stillbirth. See. Still, this is the more recorded mortality rate. And we didn't know if the death happened at the community level or the, and sometimes the refuser didn't disclose the death actually, the mortality death. So in 2022, 16 cases of maternal death were recorded. Only 16 cases were recorded. And out of the 16, 14 were, was the review was done through the MPDSR, the maternal and the prenatal death review. Yeah? The MPDSR, the SRH working group investigate the 14 cases actually. And total 480 stillbirth and the 168 neonatal deaths were recorded during the 2020. this is not the actual number, and the actual number could be more than this one. This is the published information, but though it is low, but alarming. Yeah, 480 stillbirth and the 168 neonatal death were recorded. So this is not the single number, and not is the negligible number. So the midwifery teams may work on it actually. So
gimana ibu kan?
This is the problem about the, so maybe we have to need the better care for the mothers during the pregnancy and things. And this is the child health section, and this is the last section for my lecture. So child health section. So child health, what is the evidence showing? Evidence showing that 54% of the Rohingya refugees are children. So which I already told. So 54% of the total population are the children, and they need the humanitarian assistance, and they need the really, really active and the prompt humanitarian assistance. And out of the total consultation for the child, nearly 1/3 have respiratory infections. So that means the children who have consulted with the doctors at the facility levels, and out of them, 32% have the respiratory infection, ARI. So most of the people have the ARI. 1/4 have the cases with the unexplained fever. So 27 have the unexplained fever. This both are very anxious for the epidemiologist. And we have to work very closely with the health facilities for the reporting, as well as the ensure the treatment actually. And the cases of acute watery diarrhea, skin disease, injuries, and the eye infections and the malaria was also found among the group of the children. And there is an outbreak of the AWD. So last year when I was with them, I was with the WHO, and before the last year, they have also the acquired water diarrhea outbreak. The every year during the dry season, there is a scarcity of the water, the fresh water or drinking water. So for that reason, the AWD cases were increased, and it was in the outbreak. And the nutritional deficiencies also found among the children, and this is more on the underweight babies, stunting, the wasting, and the iron deficiency anemia is highly prevalent among the Rohingya children. See, due to the nutritional deficiency, this is the problem actually. And the female children also reported as a female children also facing problem with the mental stress regarding their insecurity in terms of, as they have to use the a common space with the other male peoples, and this is the densely area actually. Mungkin satu tenda ada 10 orang, satu block ada 100 ada 5000 orang tinggal. Jadi beberapa meter atau beberapa square meter ada ribuan orang, jadi ada mental stress, and they have to share the private space in the household. In there is no separate space for the female child and the home. They have only one room for the family, only one room for the 6 or 7 members family. So there is no options for the separate room for the female child actually. So this is the another mental health problem. And the vaccination actually, so see, many of the children health diseases are the vaccine preventable. So there is many children are affected by many diseases which is the vaccine preventable actually. And the target population for the vaccine, see, So about the 52,000, more than 52,000 children are the target population for the immunization. So immunization, eligible baby by untuk immunization, itu sekitar ya 52,300 bayis. Jadi among them, 25,000 are the 0 to 11 months. So kosong sampai 11 bulan itu 25,000-an. Jadi dari 12 sampai 23 bulan ya 26,000-an atau hampir 27,000-an yang vaksin. Jadi among the yang 52,000 the boys are 25,000 and the girls are 27,000. So girls are more than actually the boys. And the vaccine coverage by antigen, the coverage untuk immunisasi itu sangat sangat jelek. Sangat sangat jelek. Jadi karena orang-orang refugee atau the orang-orang Rohingya, dia tidak mau vaksinasi. Jadi program vaksinasi tidak sukses di Rohingya camp. Jadi kalau perbandingan dari national host community daripada di Rohingya community itu sangat beda. Kalau di host community, kalau di community saya itu sekitar 97% success rate. Kalau hanya di sini hanya sekitar 30%. Jadi we have to work on it very strongly. So BCG pentavalent, see the rate very low, yeah. So coverage rate very low. So this is the SRH activities, sexual and reproductive activities, the community, the household level. Ada CSW di sini lagi diskusi di sama ibu di rumah ibu actually di komunitas. Jadi household visit. So and during this visit, yeah, CSW biasa kasih service untuk apa EDD atau new pregnant mother atau they also work for the vaccination awareness. They also work for the other health awareness, the SBCC social and behavior change communications. So everything the CSW used to work at the community level, and they also bring the patient from community to the health nearby health facilities actually, and they also linking up the patient to the facility. So their role is very important actually. And this is the SRA service providing in the health facility actually, the health facility. The woman visiting the mobile medical team and fire affecting camp in SRH services. So this is the facility based SRH service for the Rohingya women, Rohingya peoples. And this is the more on the service, and there is still have some challenges to provide the services actually. To provide the services in terms of the cultural sensitivity. So cultural sensitivity is about the karena itu orang-orang refused, mereka tidak mau seeking healthcare at the health facility. Karena culture, they have the own culture. Jadi dia percaya budaya mereka. Jadi untuk ini dia tidak mau perempuan pergi di rumah sakit untuk delivery, untuk kelahiran, dia tidak mau. Untuk other services, dia tidak mau actually. Jadi, untuk awareness building, we have to work for the awareness building among the community actually. And identifying the approaches and the sampling the strategy. So, it's also the one of the challenge to identify the which method will be applicable. Will be applicable among the Rohingya people actually. And obviously, most importantly, we need to work for the community trust issues. So we are not doing anything harm for you. So we have to build awareness for that level actually. So community trust building. Jadi kalau kami bisa percaya orang-orang Rohingya, mungkin mereka bisa datang di rumah sakit atau di health facility. And I am very close to my lecture. And this is the last slide from my lecture. So this is the key summary. This is the all of the essential SRH services are mostly in upward trend. So it's increasing from the very beginning of the Rohingya influx compared with now, it's increasing actually. So this is a good sign. And we are seeing the LSM, local LSM international, the UN agencies, they are working at the community. And for that reason, this is all are increasing. And the PNC service are increasing, ANC service are increasing, family planning and also increasing. And also this response also helps for the COVID-19 response actually. And the facility-based delivery increased 28%. So this is huge. And see 142,000 first time visit of family planning were reported in 2020. So more than target actually. And the coordinated efforts, that means the all sector, the health sector is the head. Where I used to work, the Bawa health sector at the SREs, at the nutrition sector, at the emergency sector, that is the more coordination among the groups, working groups and the stakeholders was instrumental and continuity to the SRE services provision and delivery in the face of the COVID-19 pandemic. So during this COVID-19 pandemic, they also able to provide the all services. So this is my last slide actually. So thank you for your patience to hearing this one. So I am back to the Bafera, the moderator or the yeah, okay, so. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Soherana. Now I will invite the participant to give question. Thank you for the informative and interesting talk. All right, ladies and gentlemen and all the participants, now we come to question and answer session. There will be two sessions and each session is for three questions. Don't forget to mention your name. Okay, you can raise hand or ketik langsung di chat room ya, boleh juga. Oke, okay, any question? Ya. Yeah. Silahkan Bu Nur Dewi Sulimbona. Pertanyaan yang pertama dari Bu Nur Dewi Sulimbona.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih atas kesempatan yang diberikan. Saya Nur Dewi Sulimbona dari kebetulan dosen prodi S1 dan profesi kebidanan STIKES Kuningan. Izin Pak Cecep ya. Kami sudah banyak mendengar dari Pak Cecep mengenai Mr. Sohel. Nah, kebetulan beliau menceritakan salah satunya bahwa pernah bersekolah di Indonesia ya Pak, ya Mr. Sohel ya. Ya, dan ya, merupakan ya, sahabat dari Pak Cecep. Nah, jadi alhamdulillah kami mendapatkan banyak informasi. Nah, mungkin pertanyaan saya di sini mengenai tentang Mr. Sohel sendiri, pandangan Mr. Sohel tentang di Indonesia itu seperti apa? Nedik now about environment, culture, and people in Indonesia. Mungkin kan barangkali sudah lama di Indonesia dan pernah bercimbun di Indonesia, dunia kesehatan di Indonesia. Nah, mungkin gambaran-gambaran apa yang Mr. Sohail dapatkan di Indonesia mengenai kesehatan khususnya maternal dan reproduksi di Indonesia. Terima kasih, mungkin seperti itu.
Saya menjawab ini atau ambil pertanyaan lain lagi. Maybe we can answer one by one, ya. So that will be
okay. Yeah, one by one aja, Mr. Okay. Sohail.
Ya, terima kasih Ibu Nur Dewi. And itu saya sangat senang itu kuliah di Indonesia itu. Waktu saya itu dari 2011 sampai 2014 saya di Jogja di UGM. Jadi 3 tahun saya di sana, 1 tahun belajar bahasa Indonesia dan 2 tahun untuk kuliah ada S2 di FK UGM. Sama kelasnya Pak Cecep. Mas Cecep, ya. Jadi ya, kita angkatan 2012. Jadi kalau culture sama orang-orang di Indonesia saya sangat suka. Kalau satu kata itu saya sangat suka da orang-orang Indonesia sama culture-nya. Karena culture-nya itu diverse culture. Jadi kalau Jawa itu satu culture, kalau di Bali culture-nya beda, di Sumatera culture-nya beda. Dan itu Jogja atau di UGM itu campuran, semuanya ada campuran. Karena ada teman saya dari Medan, ada Aceh, dari Sumatera, dari Jawa Barat, dari Jawa Tengah, dari Yogyakarta, dari Bali, di apa namanya, di Yang Timur, jadi saya ada teman-teman di sana. Jadi saya bisa belajar culture dari mereka. Dan juga yang makanan di Jogja ada semua daerah-daerah makanan juga di Jogja. Jadi bisa mengsharekan itu ya di culture-nya. Dan itu orang-orang dan teman-teman saya dari itu sangat baik. Mereka itu sangat baik. Jadi karena itu saya belajar bahasa 1 tahun, tapi untuk bahasa saya untuk akademik tidak bagus sebenarnya. Untuk sehari-hari mungkin itu lumayan cukup. Jadi untuk kuliah, semua kuliah tadi itu bahasa Indonesia. Tapi teman-teman saya, dia sangat bantu saya. Jadi saya bisa mengerti di kuliah-kuliah ini. Jadi ya, jadi saya juga ada teman-teman kalau di waktu hari raya, saya biasa datang di rumah teman saya di Jawa Tengah. Jadi untuk ini, jadi saya ada keluarga. Saya Indonesia seperti saya itu second home. Jadi saya 2014 balik di Bangladesh, 2015, 2014, 2017 saya ke Indonesia. Tapi after ini saya belum jadi karena ada rencana tapi belum jadi. Tapi kalau ada percaya, saya harus ke Indonesia. Jadi Indonesia sepertinya itu second home saya. Dan untuk kesehatan itu Indonesia one of the ambitious country, itu negara-negara yang ambitious untuk JKN, ya. Karena Indonesia udah siapkan untuk JKN, udah mulai JKN dari 2014. We didn't go for the bad or benefit or the challenges, we didn't go it, but at least Indonesia started the universal health coverage for all from 2014. And many of the countries in the world, they didn't able to start the JKN or the universal health coverage for all. But Indonesia already started it. And this is the huge things for the people. And they make the health system more strength by the community, Puskesmas. And yesterday, the 2 weeks ago, the dua minggu yang lalu saya ada kuliah sama di USU, the University of South Sumatra Utara. Jadi kami ada kuliah untuk UKBM. Jadi kita lihat di JKN itu sekarang sangat baik. Dan itu sangat baik in terms of providing the services. And sekitar 82% yang service dari Puskesmas. Jadi itu sangat baik. Dan itu health system the disease surveillance di Indonesia itu sangat baik. Menurut saya itu udah kuat. Kami we have to space to work, but it's already developed. So compare with my country in Bangladesh, Indonesia is sangat maju untuk disease surveillance. untuk JKN itu udah maju. Jadi saya kira Indonesia ekonomi, culture sama untuk kesehatan itu cuma bagus. Tapi we have many space to work actually because maybe the quality of service. Now we have to work for the quality of service. We have to work for the affordable price of the service because many of the people are the poor, yang miskin. Jadi mereka mungkin gak bisa masuk di rumah sakit. Mungkin mereka gak bisa bayar untuk yang tes atau di rumah sakit. Jadi we have to work on it actually more, make it more more friendly. So in the universal health coverage definition, so the access to the healthcare for the poor people without any financial hardship. So we have to work on it. But menurut saya itu Indonesia sekarang udah maju, udah mulai JKN, udah ada committee sendiri. Jadi they are is still going on, but we have to work on it. So Ibu Nur Dewi, bagaimana?
Yeah.
Very happy with the answer.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Sohel.
Okay.
For answer this question. Yes.
Okay. Baik, untuk pertanyaan selanjutnya dari mahasiswa kita, Mr. Sohel, Dila Silvani Lutfiera, silakan untuk bertanya.
Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, Mr. Sohel, the lecturers, and all of the participants. My name is Dila Silvani Lutfiera. I'm a level 2 student, Bachelor of Midwifery. So my question is, INC and PNC visit to healthcare facility in Bangladesh is low because some of taboo religious, right? Is the World Health Organization in Bangladesh open or accept the health volunteers from outside the country to help the health workers there to educating the citizen of Bangladesh that ANC and PNC is visit is very important. Thank you. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay, thank you Silviani. So that's one correction itu jadi kuliah ini hari ini untuk Rohingya refugee ya. Jadi ANC PNC itu kurang di masyarakat Rohingya, bukan masyarakat di Bangladesh ya. Jadi masyarakat Bangladesh ANC PNC udah tinggi, udah lumayan bagus ya. Mungkin tidak sampai yang standar, tapi lumayan bagus. Tapi kurang ini, jadi masyarakat Rohingya yang refugee. Jadi ini karena itu ya, udah mention itu tabu, ada cultural tabu. Karena itu orang-orang Rohingya yang male partner, mereka tidak mau istri saya pergi di rumah sakit untuk konsultasi atau USG ultrasonogram, dia tidak mau. Jadi ada volunteer kami di Rohingya refugee setting, ada volunteer juga, we call the CHW, the community health worker, as well as the volunteer, untuk awareness building among them. And the WHO is the leading of the health sector, and the WHO is working on it. And under the WHO, the UNFPA, United Nations Family Organization for the Family Planning. So UNFPA is leading this SRA's working group, and they are directly working with the community to awareness with the peoples. But I am not sure about your second question about the international volunteer, because there might be a language barrier. So the Rohingya people have the another language. We Bangladeshi have the Bengali language. So we have already some barrier, the language communications. So, but in the local, in the Chittagong, the Cox's Bazar, the local language itu apa bahasa yang lokal itu sama dengan Rohingya. Jadi orang-orang di lokal tinggal di sana, they are used to make the awareness program. Jadi okay. But I will explore the international volunteer option And maybe I will, if the information, I will share with the MasterChef. Yeah, thank you, Silviani.
Yeah, thank you for the answer, Mr. Sohel.
Thank you.
Baik, Mr. Soherana, untuk pertanyaan, sebelum melangkah ke pertanyaan selanjutnya, mohon untuk men-stop share screen-nya, Mister. Mohon maaf.
Stop share,
okay. Iya. Yeah.
Okay, no, yeah.
Okay, baik. Untuk pertanyaan, for the next question, Magfira, silahkan.
Baik, terima kasih Ibu Dera. Sebelumnya, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, my name is Magfira Maulani, bachelor degree, student of midwifery in Stikes Kuningan. I'd like to ask Mr. Sohel related to stunting inward. Inward stunting still considered as the highest in mind issue in society, di mana stunting ini masih menjadi masalah yang utama dan tinggi di dunia gitu. Even talk three is a socialization about it, but still three are many people who don't understand about it. Walaupun misalkan sudah ada penanganannya, tapi masih saja ada yang belum tahu secara menyeluruh gitu terkait stunting penanganannya bagaimana. How your opinion related to that issue in Rohingya, Bangladesh? Jadi bagaimana pandangan Mister terkait isu tersebut di Rohingya di Bangladesh gitu? Apakah memang sama ataukah tidak gitu tingginya stunting itu? Is there any insular service in our society about this issue? Apakah memang adanya ketidakmerataan gitu terhadap pelayanannya? And what kind of solution that we can effort for those who live in the remote area with no as a low technology and low upset area? Apakah memang ada solusinya yang memang bisa diterapkan di daerah yang memang minim sekali teknologi? Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Ibu Magfira. Ya. Mungkin ya. Jadi ada suaranya itu. This is breaking actually. But I can. So you are asking about the stunting status of the Rohingya peoples, right? And also the what is the solution for it and how we can make it in the direct pencil. Yeah.
Yes. It's right.
Okay. Okay, maybe I'm not sure how I will answer, but stunting compared with the national community, the Rohingya community saya sama the Rohingya community, stunting itu tinggi di Rohingya communities. Rohingya communities itu tinggi. Jadi karena itu stunting, it could be many reasons. One of the nutritional status actually. So nutritional status is one of them, because during the pregnancy, mothers not used to get the good food actually. Though we have the manicure from the health services for the special food for the pregnant mother or something, but do you know, honestly I say, when they will get it and they are not used to with that food actually, so they sell it to the outside. The special food is they sell to the outside. For that reason, there's a less of the nutritional one, and also the nutritional support for the babies there actually. But due to the awareness one, or the due to the not introduced with the system, this is the stunting is still strong with them. But for solution is still there is no alternative of the awareness building actually. And there is no alternative. We have to work for the awareness building among that community. We have to the practical based information. So we have to practical information to introduce the, for the standing, how we can solve it and how it works on it. Maybe the one of the, for the diode that pencil, the technology is not updated. There is a two options to work actually. So one option is strengthening the local health system. The posyandu atau the puskesmas, kita harus kekuatan the puskesmas atau the posyandu di sana. Then another one is the KKN, because the Indonesian University ada program the KKN ya. Kalau di mahasiswa S1 dia mereka biasa ditinggal satu daerah atau di daerah terpencil untuk 2 bulan 3 bulan. Jadi kalau mahasiswa KKN main target untuk di just for the stunting, maybe they can share the awareness program. They can train the volunteer from their community, and they can use the supplement for the community. So by that way, maybe the KKN, mahasiswa KKN bisa bantu masyarakat yang perlu support untuk stunting. Terima kasih, Pak Makfira.
Cukup ya? Yeah, thank you, Mr. Sohel. Cukup.
Okay, thank you.
Baik, untuk sesi terakhir, sesi yang kedua, silakan. Any question? You can raise your hand and you also you can type in the chat room.
Bisa tulis di chat box yang bahasa Indonesia. Gak apa-apa. Saya akan coba untuk translation in English ya.
Iya, so, jadi boleh pakai bahasa Indonesia ya, silakan. Ada pertanyaan? Baik, ada yang ingin bertanya? Dila Silvani?
Sudah, Bu.
Sudah. Baik, barangkali Mr. Soherana ingin ada yang ditambahkan? Silakan.
Not really, but maybe for the Pak Cecep already here atau sudah di
okay. Kalau misal okay. saya baru gabung lagi.
Okay, tidak apa-apa ya. Okay, thank you. Jadi ya mungkin dari saya itu apa minat kebidanan itu sangat penting di negara-negara dimanapun itu bidan itu sangat penting. Then they can contribute from the planning of the pregnancy up to the PNC and the other services actually. So only one midwife, good midwife, can make the one good nation actually. So from the pregnancy, ANC, PNC and delivery, only the bidan can help them very well. So I'm happy actually there, because Indonesia has a very good practice actually. Indonesia is very good practice on the kesmas atau the kebidanan. There is many organization in Indonesia, they have the providing the midwife training. But in Bangladesh, we have the more doctor less than the keperawatan, the nurse less than the midwife. We have the more doctor. We have the less nurse or the midwives. But Indonesia, they have the more midwives, and there's more available than anywhere. So that is the one of the good sign in Indonesia. If we can use this midwifery program very efficiently and the comprehensively, then it will be very good for the all actually for achieving the JKN. Yeah, kalau saya if I manage with the JKN, because ultimate goal is the JKN. Yeah, for Indonesia, for Bangladesh as well, the universal coverage. So ultimate goal is to achieve the JKN targets. Jadi kalau ya untuk increase the ANC visit, increase the PNC, and also the institutional delivery, post-abortion care. By this way, the midwife can reduce the maternal mortality, the infant mortality, and the stunting as well. By this way, it will be hit on the Jacquard target, and ultimately after several years Jacquard target will be achieved, and it will be, and Indonesia will be more self-sustained in the health innovation actually. So I think the B2IP program has a very good contribution in the achieving the Jacquard. And for the B2IP program, I believe the STKs have the good program and the good academic good program, but PATHHF and others may work on the more collaborative works with the other institution in the inside Indonesia and outside Indonesia for make it more comprehensive program, to make it the world renowned program actually. So this is something for me. Okay, maybe there is one question from in chat box. Let me. Oh.
Okay. One question again, Mr. Sahil Hane. In conflict and the massacre of the Rohingya, the sexual and reproductive health rights of female refugees are often ignored in conflict and disaster situation. Many parties tend to understand that in a crisis situation, reproductive health services are not urgent. There are other health issues that are more urgent, such as handling injured victims. And how do we realize that reproductive health is also very important? Thank you. Pertanyaannya dari Putri Bunga Amelia, Mr. Mahasiswa.
Okay. Thank you for the very good question. I appreciate the question. And this is the reality actually. This is the reality. People don't. So we have to prioritize the problem. We have to prioritize it. So very beginning of the influx in 2017, there is nothing for health. There is zero for health. Yeah. So that time focus on the food, only food, and only the residents. So the more focus on the food and residents, then it comes to health. Health, then more on the primary health care. Then under health, it comes to the SRAs later. So it took at least 1 year from the influx for establishing the SRA services. And it is very important actually. So I appreciate the question, but from very beginning, we have to work with the other sector, because there is in any emergency, there is one governing body, like in Bangladesh, the Rohingya one, there was ISCG, Inter-Sector Coordination Group. So they are the governing body for coordinating the all sector, the health sector, food sector, protection sector, shelter sector, nutrition sector, wash sector, everyone. So for the if I am the responsible for the SRA services, I have to coordinate with the ISCG to ensure the services, the SRA services for the emergency. And we have to work at the policy level first. If we want to work at the bottom level, it will not work. Believe me, it will not work. So first of all, we have to work at the policy level. Policy level, then once policy level will approve it, policy people will approve it, then you can easily implement in the local level, in the down level. Otherwise, it will not work. So first of all, we have to sensitize the policy people. Kalau sepertinya kalau darurat, kalau ada gempa di Jogja, support karena ada Merapi, ya ada Merapi di atas. Kalau ada gempa di sana, jadi maybe the evacuation must be done. So in evacuation process, not only the male people will come, eh? So male will come, yang pria, wanita, bayi, anak, yang pregnant, semua will evacuate. But the need is not same for all. Yeah, maybe the pregnant woman need the special care, the baby need the special care, but for the people who are managing the all things, they have to think which is the most important, which need to be prioritized. So the woman the baby should be prioritized. Under the woman and the baby, the pregnant, the old, the elder woman should be prioritized. So by this way, we can share the we can prioritize the SRI's kids, and also the maybe the during the emergency, the menstruation may be start. Yeah, one of the female, the menstruation could be start. So then she needs the special care. So we have to think about that care as well. So we have to prepare the one comprehensive plan before any emergency, and we have to include the SRI issues in the policy level. I believe by this way it will be works. And thanks for the question.
Thank you for the answer. Maybe to all the participants, any question again, you can raise your hand or you can type in on the chat room. Okay, any question? Okay. Yeah. Baik, finally we came to the end part of our expert lecture. We would like to say thanks again to Mr. Sohel Rana for the informative and interesting talk, and to the audience for active participation. Hopefully the expert lecture will be beneficial for everybody. Thank you for your attention. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Then I will give the agenda to the MC, Mrs. Vera, please.
Okay, thank you so much, Mr. Sohel, for the best material. Thank you for coming, Mr. Sohel, and warm greetings for your family in Bangladesh. And thank you so much, Mrs. Dera, as a moderator. We hope that the material we have obtained can be useful for all of us. Amin ya rabbal alamin. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we continue our agenda. Is the Harebi presented of the certificate for Mr. Sohel as a speaker today by Mr. Cecep as symbolized. Okay, silakan Pak Cecep menyerahkan secara simbolis sertifikatnya kepada Mr. Sohel. Dan tim IT mohon dibantu untuk didokumentasikan.
Oke, okay, Mr. Sohel, ini saya serahkan sertifikat ya, mudah-mudahan menjadi amal baik ya, Mr. Sohel, berbagi pengetahuan, berbagi pengalaman ya, kepada kami semua, dan mudah-mudahan menjadi motivasi. Dan tentu kalau saya menyampaikan adalah, kita memang di negara bencana, jadi memang kita harus bersiap bagaimana menghadapi bencana, termasuk dampak dari kesehatan reproduksi ya. Saya senang sekali mendapatkan penjelasan tadi dari berbagai pertanyaan teman-teman semua ya, mahasiswa S1 yang profesi. Dan saya yakin mereka memiliki potensi dan kita insya Allah sama-sama mampu bersaing pada tataran nasional maupun tataran global. Jadi ke depan mungkin bisa jadi ada bidan Indonesia yang bekerja di Bangladesh gitu ya, atau di negara-negara lain gitu ya. Makanya kita perlu persiapan betul. Dan mudah-mudahan Mr. Sohel bisa memberikan terus pengalaman kepada kami, gitu, dan membantu, terutama membantu Stikes Kuningan untuk bisa berkiprah di global. Oke, thank you, Mr. Sohel.
Thank you very much for the nice certificate, and I am looking forward to working with again, and maybe we can work for the we can working to the kerjasama ya, kerjasama sama Stikes sama saya atau the organisasi saya. Jadi very good things for me, and the most amazing is for me the participant is 180 and this is my first time to give lecture with the in front of the 180 people, and this is very honor for me actually. And okay, thank you.
Nah, ini Mr. Sohel, perlu saya sampaikan ini yang ikut ini mahasiswa bachelor-nya ya, yang satunya mahasiswa D3 diplomanya. Kemudian masuk profesi ini, kalau istilah di sini mahasiswa non reguler atau mereka yang sudah bekerja, ya. Nah, kemudian para dosen juga ibu-ibu nih, saya say hello juga nih ibu-ibu dosennya ya. Tadi ada yang sudah bergabung. Mulai dari MC-nya, moderatornya, kaprodinya, semua para dosen ya. Nah, itu juga sudah bergabung di acara kita.
Maybe one day I will meet with you all in the Stikes Kuningan.
Oke, okay, amin.
Kalau COVID-19 sudah selesai, dan kalau saya jalan-jalan di Indonesia, nanti saya harus jalan-jalan di Stiket.
Ya, mudah-mudahan ya kita bisa main ke Kuningan di sini. Bagus sekali wisatanya. Ya. Oke, mungkin itu Mrs. Vera.
Mr. Jep and Mr. Cordial, can you thumbs up? I will take a picture.
Oke.
Okay.
Thumbs up and smile. 1, 2, 3. Once again, 1, 2, 3. Okay, thank you, Mr. Sahal and Mr. Jep.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Nenen, for take a picture. Okay, next we share photo session. Mrs. Nenen mungkin bisa dibantu lagi untuk dokumentasi per slide-nya.
Okay, this is 8th page. I will take page 1. Okay, all the participants, can you show your video? Start again. Okay. Please, Solihati Brebes, can you show your video? Are you ready now? Please, all participants. Okay, take 1, 2, 3. Okay, next, the page 2. Mohon videonya di-on-kan semua dulu ya. Ini masih banyak yang belum on. Iya, halaman kedua, 1, 2, 3. Silakan aktifkan dulu videonya, soalnya mungkin Anda tidak tahu di halaman berapa. Silakan aktifkan dulu videonya semua. Show your video, please. 1, 2. Okay, page 4. Okay, it's done. Thank you so much for our participant.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Nenen. Ladies and gentlemen, we arrive at the end of the agenda, which is the closing prayer, who will be read by Mr. Sutisna. Time is yours.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. A'udzu billahi minasy syaithanir rajim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Hamdan syakirin, hamdan na'imin, hamdan jafi ni'amah ya kafi mazidah. Ya Rabbana lakal hamdu wa lakal syukru kama yanbaghi li jalali wajhika wa 'azimi sultanik. Allahumma shalli wa sallim 'ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa 'ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. Ya Allah, ya Tuhan kami, segala puji untuk-Mu, pemelihara alam semesta. Segala puji atas karunia dan kenikmatan yang Engkau limpahkan kepada kami. Segala puji atas keagungan-Mu. Segala puji atas kemuliaan-Mu dan kekuasaan-Mu. Ya Maliku ya Kudus, kami agungkan nama-Mu karena hanya Engkaulah Tuhan kami. Hanya kepada-Mu kami bersujud, hanya kepada-Mu kami bersyukur, dan hanya kepada-Mu kami memanjatkan doa. Ya Allah, Ya Rahim, hanya kepada-Mu kami menyembah, dan hanya kepada-Mu kami memohon pertolongan. Ya Rabbana, hari ini kami berkumpul di sini dalam kegiatan kuliah pakar kepidanan pada tahun 2021 ini. Karenanya, Ya Allah, lancarkanlah acara kami ini, berkahilah, penuhilah pertemuan ini dengan kebaikan dari awal hingga akhir nanti. Bukalah pikiran kami, pikiran hati kami, agar dapat menyerap semua materi dan dapat mengamalkannya dengan baik di tengah keluarga kami, masyarakat dan bangsa negara yang kami cintai, ya Allah. Ya Allah yang Maha Mengetahui yang gaib, bimbinglah kami dengan hidayah-Mu, berkahilah kami selalu dengan takdir-Mu, dan jadikanlah hati kami selalu ridho dengan pemberian-Mu. Rabbi srahli sodri wa yassir li amri wa akhlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. Ya Tuhanku, lapangkanlah dada kami dan lancarkanlah hidup kami serta mudahkanlah urusan kami. Allahumma adil haqq wa haqq wa rajul tindaba wa nal batil batil wa jil tindaba tibda. Ya Rabbana, Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanah wa fil akhirati hasanah wa qina adzaban nar. Subhanallahi rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa sallam. Al-Fatiha.
Alhamdulillahirrahmanirrahim.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahirrabbilalamin. Rahmanirrahim. Maliki yamdin. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. Ihdinas siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladzina an'amta 'alaihim ghairil maghdubi 'alaihim waladdallin. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Amin. Allahumma amin. Thank you so much, Mr. Sutisna. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your attention and presence at this expert lecture today. Alhamdulillah, all agendas are running smoothly according to our mutual wishes. I hope we meet again on another occasion, and I'm sorry if during this event many mistakes from me. Okay, thank you so much, Mr. Sohel.
Thank you so much, and I also seek permission or so just if you need any further information, just please feel free to reach me. So I have my number with the Pachachev and the Buai. So just okay. If you have any question about the any health systems or the any about any question about this lecture, please feel free to reach me. And thank you for your patience. And okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Sohel. Oke, baik para hadirin semuanya, marilah kita tutup acara ini dengan membaca hamdalah bersama-sama. Alhamdulillahirabbil alamin.
Amin.
Nasrun minallah wa fatun qorib. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih, Mr. Sohel.
Oke. Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam
warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Mau matiin. Sebentar, sebentar. Teman-temannya ayo. Ada.
Mama udah berangkat.
Ibu, ini udah selesai. Halo? Udah selesai, Ibu?